Beach gold in Australia is so rare that most prospectors don't even realise it exists. In Alaska, you get whole towns built on storm-washed pay streaks and offshore dredges chewing through auriferous sands. Here, the coastline feels too young, too energetic, too clean to hide real placid gold. And yet, tucked behind the dunes between Evans Head and Iluka, there was once a beach goldfield every bit as strange and improbable as Nome. A narrow, almost invisible strip of black sand that supported hundreds of miners, kept families afloat through drought and depression, and then slipped almost completely out of public memory. Today it looks like just another quiet piece of coastal heath, but a century ago it was one of the unlikeliest goldfields in the country. This video will dive into why gold existed here, what attempts were made to exploit it, and how the rush and bust unfolded. But first, a call to action. YouTube's got this new hype thing now. Apparently, it boosts the channel harder than likes and comments combined. So if you liked the video and want to genuinely support the channel for free, hit that hype button and let the algorithm know we exist. Thank you so much for your support. Now the wild part about this story is how small and strange the ore body actually was. Macaulay's lead, the main Jerusalem Creek field, wasn't a quartz reef or a river channel. It was a buried strip of cemented black sand, only about 4 to 9 meters wide, snaking for a bit over 3 kilometers behind the beach. We'll look into how this formed to begin with soon. On top sat up to 5 meters of clean white sand. Somewhere down in that black rock, about a meter or so below its top, there was a paper-thin wash layer loaded with ultra-fine gold. Missed that horizon by a few tens of centimeters, and you were just shoveling useless sand. Hit it, and you can pull a solid week's wages out of ground that looked like nothing at all. By the mid-1890s, a few beach miners had already realised the real money wasn't always on the active shoreline. Storms would strip the modern beach and expose sniggers, dark seams of heavy mineral sand that might pay for a week or two. But those patches came and went with each gale. The smarter prospectors started poking behind the dunes, chasing the idea that old shorelines might be preserved as fossil beaches further inland. That hunch paid off in 1895, when Alexander and Angus Macaulay, farmers who prospected in the off-season, found colours almost everywhere with their sand sludger, then finally struck a proper run of payable wash on the east face of a narrow dune south of Jerusalem Creek. They kept quiet for a while, working with their brothers, until the volume of gold walking out to the storekeepers made secrecy impossible. Once word got out, the beach filled fast. Within months, there were a couple of hundred men at Jerusalem Creek. By the peak, 400 miners and 500 to 600 people in total were living in tents and rough huts strung along the lead. It wasn't some lawless frontier out on the edge of nowhere either. They had a school with 15 kids, a general store, 2 restaurants, an oyster saloon, pop-up beer shacks, athletic meets, even a cricket club grandly named the Pacific Club. The halfway house hotel and a track in from the highway towns became the social funnel, and mail was delivered right to the claims twice a week by an overachieving postie. For something that started with a seam of black sand under a dune, it briefly became a full-blown community. On paper, the field shouldn't have worked as well as it did. This wasn't chunky alluvial gold you could pick out with tweezers. It was mostly flour, superfine particles mixed in with a heavy mineral soup of rutile, zircon, ilmenite, monazite, cassiterite, and a trace of platinum and garnet. The miners began the way beach workers at Ballina and New Zealand Beach had done in the 1870s, using portable sluice boxes with carpet or corduroy and mercury-coated copper plates. But the assays showed they were losing a depressing amount of gold because the grains were coated in a brown, organic, iron oxide film. In classic field tinkerer fashion, they turned the place into a giant backyard chemistry lab. First came washing soda, then a 1% caustic soda wash in boiling solution, mixed in 200-gallon ship tanks, and run down long iron-lined troughs to clean the gold before it met the mercury. Once they nailed that, they could skip the carpet pre-concentration entirely and process the cleaned wash straight over plates, even going back and reworking their own old tailings for another shot at the metal. One party took a pile of tailings that had already given up 200 ounces and squeezed another 100 ounces out of it, just by retreating with the improved method. Even with all that effort, this was never a Bendigo scale bonanza. Official Mines Department numbers for 1895-96 across the Ballina and McLean divisions add to 5,237 ounces, and detailed reconstruction from newspapers and Malcolm Macaulay's diary suggests Jerusalem Creek itself produced at least 3,080 ounces during the main rush. When you convert the recorded value of the gold, somewhere between 14 and 20,000 pounds to metal, you land in the range of 3.5 to 5,000 ounces for the main rush, and maybe around 5,000 ounces total for the whole life of the field. That's real money for farmers and beachcombers scratching through a depression and drought, but on the scale of Australian gold history, it's a modest, tightly focused blip. What makes Jerusalem Creek important isn't just the ounces, it's what the place did to people's thinking. You had local farmers, oystermen, and small-time miners proving you could treat a beach as an ore body, then pushing the tech from simple cradles and hand pumps into chemical pre-treatment, systematic prospecting, and eventually, early attempts at dredging. The government took notice. Inspectors like Joseph Kahn came up to sketch cross-sections of the lead and describe the black rock and its cemented bottom. The Minister for Mines sent a huge prospecting party to put down thousands of sludger holes along east-west lines behind the dunes, paying the men out of the prospecting vote so unemployed workers could have a shot at new finds. The scheme drilled over 2,800 boreholes, mapped the system in detail, and even pushed as far as Evans Head and places like Chinaman's Beach in a hunt for more buried leads. In economic terms, the program flopped. Only a small, low-grade extension lead turned up, but it forced everyone to think of the entire coastal belt as a three-dimensional placer system rather than just a strip of sand at the water's edge. But behind that mapping was a bigger geological question. Where on earth did all this heavy mineral soup actually come from? Kahn's conclusion, which still holds up pretty well, was that the black sands were built from material delivered by rivers draining granite and Paleozoic basement rocks in the New England region. Those catchments carried gold, rutile, zircon, cassiterite, and monazite to the coast, where wave action did the fine-scale sorting. The local Clarence Morden Basin sandstones, especially the Gadden sandstone, inherited those earlier heavy mineral loads in river channels and shoreline deposits, eroding them again in the Quaternary, recycling already concentrated grains back into the modern beach system. Basalts from the Tweed volcano may have chipped in some magnetite and ilmenite, but they weren't the source of gold-bearing components. One much publicised gold-bearing basalt at Blackhead turned out to be basically a lava that had slurped up pre-existing beach gold as it erupted. Even some of the miners' wilder ideas are telling. A few were convinced the gold came straight out of seawater and built an entire plant at Broken Head to strip it from the ocean, only to watch it literally get washed away. Underneath those schemes is the same instinct you've had poking around Evans Head, that the coastline itself is more than just scenery, it's a big, dynamic, concentrating machine. The really strange twist is what happened after the gold rush died. By late 1896, Macaulay's lead was mostly worked out. The Macaulays themselves had moved on to new inland fields, and what little mining continued was basically retreatment of tailings, small cyanide experiments, and half-baked syndicate plays chasing platinum, tin, monazite, or even diamonds. Through the early 1900s, dredging companies came and went, often faster than the ink could dry on their prospectuses, tripping over the same problem. Too many heavy minerals in very fine grain sizes, and no good way to separate them at high throughput. Investors lost a lot more than they made, but the underlying idea refused to die. By the 1920s and 30s, people like Cecil Cumberland were back on the beaches, this time caring less about the gold and more about the rutile and zircon for paint pigments and refractories. New processing ideas like selective flotation, and later spiral concentrators and electromagnetic separators, finally cracked the mineral separation problem. Once that tech clicked, the same style of black sand that had kept poor beach miners alive for a couple of winters turned into the backbone of a world-class heavy mineral sands industry. By the 1950s and 60s, dredgers were chewing through the old Jerusalem Creek deposits on an industrial scale, feeding plants that produced rutile, ilmenite, and zircon for paint, welding rods, ceramics, and more. In the mid-1970s, Australia was supplying the overwhelming majority of the world's rutile and a huge slice of its zircon, and a decent chunk of that story runs straight through those quiet dunes behind Evans Head. The sand miners even recovered some gold as a byproduct of processing, although nobody seems to have bothered recording how much. A ghost echo of the original rush, trapped in the circuitry of a plant designed for titanium instead of treasure. And now, if you camp at Blackrock and wander up the fire trail, you'll walk straight over Macaulay's lead without knowing it. The beaches have been levelled, the old trenches backfilled, the big later dredge ponds reshaped and revegetated. Apart from the odd cemented black rock ledge at the beach and a few photos in local museums, almost nothing on the ground hints that 5,000 ounces of gold once came out of this scrub. In a way, that's the perfect summary of the whole story. A modest little goldfield, largely forgotten, that quietly rewired how people thought about beaches, placers, and heavy minerals, and accidentally lit the fuse on a multi-billion dollar sand mining industry. Geologists now wrap that whole saga up under one deceptively simple title, The Golden Sands of Jerusalem Creek. But the next time you're out around Evans Head, it's hard not to feel that that name understates just how weirdly influential those anonymous dunes turned out to be. I hope you found this as interesting as I did, and as always, thanks for watching. Before I end this video, I'd like to give a big shout out to my Patreon and YouTube members. Thank you so much to everyone that helps to support this channel.